My dear friends, today I will be discussing about treatment of dilated cardiomyopathy. Now, dilated cardiomyopathy is a type of cardiomyopathy where the heart becomes weak, dilated, as well as enlarged. That is, the left ventricle or right ventricle of the heart undergoes weakening and wall become thin and dilated, chamber become dilated and the musculature become very weak. And that's why the pumping quality of the heart gradually decreases over time, and which may ultimately complicate to give rise to heart failure. Now, dilated cardiomyopathy may appear in general population in the ratio 1:2500 or 2500. Means out of 2500 population, one can get this disease. Now, there are various risk factors which affects the dilated cardiomyopathy, like alcoholism, and most common of them is the idiopathic, or where the reason or the cause of the disease is not known. Beside metabolic risk factors like diabetes, hypertension, then obesity, alcoholism may affect this, and there are many risk factors, even genetic factors or mutation in the gene responsible for formation of the cytoskeletal protein structure may also lead to the disease. So these are the various risk factors which are important for causing dilated cardiomyopathy. Now, today we will be discussing about what are the various treatment of dilated cardiomyopathy. Now, dilated cardiomyopathy, if you want to know the treatment or therapeutic management or management of the disease, we must know what are the complications. Now, the dilated cardiomyopathy may lead to heart failure. So that is one of the important complication of dilated cardiomyopathy. Beside that, it also leads to mitral regurgitation or tricuspid regurgitation or valvular heart disease or heart valve disease. Beside, it can also leads to arrhythmia, cardiac arrhythmia, which may be life threatening also, for which we need to give pacemaker also. Beside, it may also leads to blood clotting disorders like ischemic stroke, hemorrhagic stroke, for which we need to give anticoagulants also. Even atrial fibrillation, if it is positive, we must add anticoagulation in therapy of dilated cardiomyopathy so as to prevent the cardiac arrhythmia and the thromboembolism, which may lead to stroke and pulmonary embolism or various thromboembolic phenomena. Now, we'll start the treatment strategy or therapeutic management of dilated cardiomyopathy. So most important treatment or intervention that must be done in dilated cardiomyopathy is to cut down the salt in our diet, or in simply we must say it is we have to restrict the salt intake. So salt intake will prevent the afterload, because when salt is taken less amount of water will be reabsorbed through kidneys, and then that's why the volume expansion of the blood will be less. And because of low sodium in the diet, the less sodium will be reabsorbed, and that's why ultimately plasma volume in the blood will be less. And because of that, the afterload in the blood on the heart, or pressure on the heart, or volume overload on the heart will be decreased. So low pressure, if you want to maintain low pressure or normal pressure, we must take low sodium in our diet, because high sodium diet may lead to hypertension, and which may increase the afterload on the heart and aggravate the heart failure because of volume overload on the heart. That's why we must advise low salt diet or salt restricted diet so as to prevent the signs, symptoms or heart failure in these dilated cardiomyopathy patients. Next important therapeutic strategy or drug responsible for management of dilated cardiomyopathy is angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors. It includes remipril, captopril, lisinopril. So these are the various drugs. Also, they are also called AC inhibitors or angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors. And by blocking these enzyme, we are going to prevent the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2, and that's why angiotensin production will be less. Now angiotensin 2 actually is a potent vasoconstriction, and because of that blood pressure rise, and it also regulate the kidney blood flow. And at the same time, angiotensin 2 is also responsible for secretion one hormone known as aldosterone in the kidney, which is responsible for sodium and water retention, leading to volume expansion and hypertension. So by blocking the angiotensin 2 formation, or by blocking the angiotensin converting enzyme, we are preventing the formation of angiotensin 2. And angiotensin 2 is a potent vasoconstrictor and hypertensive substance in our blood. By doing that, actually angiotensin 2 is less formed. By taking angiotensin E, or angiotensin converting enzyme, or ACE inhibitors, we are going to block the angiotensin converting enzyme, and thus angiotensin 2 production is less. And because of low production of angiotensin 2, there will be vasodilation or less vasoconstriction, leading to fall in blood pressure, as well as low sodium and water retention, leading to low blood pressure. Because of all these mechanism, ultimately pressure will be low, the afterload will be low, and effect on the heart will be less, and ultimately it will prevent the heart failure, as well as it also improve the working function of the heart, or heart function. So angiotensin enzyme converting enzyme inhibitors, or we simply call ACE inhibitors, is responsible to control the high blood pressure, or decrease the afterload, or pressure overload on the heart, and thus prevent the heart failure sign symptoms, and prevent the complication of the dilated cardiomyopathy. Besides, angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors can also helps in prevention of cardiac remodeling, or helps in cardiac remodeling, and prevents the hypertensive effect, or prevents heart failure also. And any type of changes the heart occurs because of pressure overload or volume overload can be prevented by angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors. And overall function of the heart is also increased by angiotensin converting enzyme, but there are some side effects like hyperkalemia, and there may be some side effects in the kidney and liver, and cough may be there. So these are the various side effects of angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors like captopril, lisinopril, enalapril. So these are angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, and by doing that we are preventing the vasoconstriction function of angiotensin 2. There is less production of angiotensin 2, and there is a less vasoconstriction, so there is a fall in blood pressure, and it keep the blood pressure and lower the blood pressure. And biggest thing is that it is responsible for long run blood pressure regulation. So by the effect of angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, we are going to keeping the blood pressure normal, at the we are decreasing the pressure overload and volume overload on the heart, and also increase the and improves the heart function, and thus it prevents the heart failure, and it also responsible for cardiac remodeling. Now there is another group of drug known as angiotensin receptor blocker, like losartan, telmisartan. So these are another group of drug known as angiotensin receptor blocker, or angiotensin 2 receptor blocker. So this group of drug is specially given when the subject or the patient is hypersensitive to ACE inhibitors, or they are not so much tolerable to angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, ACE inhibitors. And for those subjects, we can use angiotensin receptor blocker. They can also help in long run regulation of blood pressure, as well as they also help in lowering the blood pressure, decreasing the afterload, and thus improves the sign symptoms of dilated cardiomyopathy, and prevents the development of heart failure. And it also responsible for protecting the heart from the high pressure or afterload action on the over the heart. Thus, it prevents the appearance of sign symptoms of heart failure, or prevents the progression of heart failure in case of dilated cardiomyopathy. There is another group of drug known as diuretics. They are also called water pills because they are responsible for excretion of volume of water through urine. So they increase the urine formation because they prevents electrolyte and water reabsorption through the kidney renal tubules, and by doing that it is going to excrete lots of water. And diuretics, especially loop diuretics, they are responsible for blocking the sodium potassium 2Cl minus or 2 chloride channel symporter, and by doing that sodium potassium chloride all are excreted through urine, and along with that lots of water will be excreted. So diuretics are actually going to block the sodium potassium 2Cl minus co-transporter, and along with that lots of water are excreted, and by doing that the plasma volume or blood volume will decrease and ultimately blood pressure will fall. So diuretics also plays an important role in decreasing the afterload, preventing the pressure overload and volume overload of the heart, and also helps in lowering the blood pressure, and it also prevents bad effect of high pressure or high volume on the heart, and thus it also prevents the sign symptoms of heart failure. And another important function of diuretics is that it is responsible for excretion of extra water that are accumulated in the body. Now one of the important sign symptoms in dilated cardiomyopathy may be swelling of legs and various dependent parts of the body. Now the swelling can be decreased, or the fluid accumulated in the lower limbs or dependent parts in case of dilated cardiomyopathy can be relieved by taking diuretics, which is responsible for losing extra water through urine formation. And thus diuretics plays an important role in treatment of dilated cardiomyopathy. Another important drug that can be used in dilated cardiomyopathy is beta blockers. Now what is beta blockers? Beta blockers are a group of drug which is very much important because they are potent coronary vasodilator. They also helps in lowering the blood pressure. They also responsible for treatment of arrhythmia. So in case because of dilated cardiomyopathy, or if the dilated cardiomyopathy converts into some life-threatening arrhythmia or cardiac arrhythmia like atrial fibrillation, then beta blockers plays an important role. Beta blockers prevents the atrial fibrillation. It also lowers the abnormal heart rate. It also prevents tachycardia. Sinus tachycardia can be prevented by beta blocker. It also decreases the blood pressure and prevent the bad effect of pressure overload in the heart, and also decrease the heart failure. In heart failure also beta blocker has been found to be very much good because it lowers the heart rate, because when the heart is running at higher heart rate it has to do more work, and it becomes there is more stress or workload on the heart. That's why beta blocker, by lowering the heart rate, it actually lowers the blood pressure. It also decreases the workload or work stress on the heart and decrease the sign symptoms of heart failure. So it also progresses the complication of dilated cardiomyopathy. Beside, sometime if there is in dilated cardiomyopathy patients, because of complication, if they lead to atrial fibrillation or ventricular fibrillation or cardiac arrhythmia, it may leads to some conditions. It may lead to some condition known as atrial fibrillation or cardiac arrhythmia. So dilated cardiomyopathy can leads to atrial fibrillation or ventricular fibrillation or cardiac arrhythmias. And atrial fibrillation, if it is there, or if dilated cardiomyopathy leads to atrial fibrillation, then we have to treat with anticoagulants. Why? Because atrial fibrillation may be associated with thrombus formation, and it may be transferred through embolism, and it may form vascular ischemic situation like stroke or coronary heart disease or coronary ischemia, peripheral vascular disease, and so on. So it may leads to thrombotic disorder or thromboembolic phenomena, leading to various diseases which may be life-threatening also. So to prevent that, atrial fibrillation patients or dilated cardiomyopathy patients who are showing the sign symptoms of atrial fibrillation or ECG sign symptoms of atrial fibrillation can be provided with anticoagulants or oral oral anti-clotting drugs like warfarin or oral anticoagulants to prevent the development of thromboembolic phenomena. So anticoagulants are mostly indicated in case the patient is showing atrial fibrillation or cardiac arrhythmia, which may be because of complication of dilated cardiomyopathy. Besides, another important molecule known as coenzyme Q10 is also can be act as a natural supplement, and these also prevent the risk of getting heart failure in future for those patients who are suffering from dilated cardiomyopathy for long run. So coenzyme Q10 is a molecule or a substance, or can be added as a nutritional supplement which prevents the development of heart failure from the dilated cardiomyopathy. So these are the various treatment policy or treatment of dilated cardiomyopathy that is comes under medical management. Now let's move towards electrophysiological therapy, or if the patient develops some cardiac arrhythmia or abnormality in rhythm pattern of the heart, it may leads to cardiac arrhythmia, and to treat that, various electrophysiological intervention becomes must. So electrophysiological intervention, number one is artificial pacemaker or biventricular pacemaking. Now by doing that, we are going to treat the abnormal rhythm of heart, either sinus tachycardia or too much increase in heart rate or fibrillation or higher heart rate in atria or ventricle because of complication of dilated cardiomyopathy. Now sometimes dilated cardiomyopathy because of mitral regurgitation or tricuspid regurgitation can leads to cardiac arrhythmia, and to prevent the cardiac arrhythmia or abnormal rhythm of heart, artificial pacemaker or biventricular pacemaking are added so as to prevent the complication of cardiac arrhythmia. Beside implantable cardio defibrillator are also used. Cardiac defibrillator are also used so as to prevent the arrhythmia that may occur in heart. Besides, resynchronization therapy can also be done in some patients who are showing cardiac arrhythmia because of complication of dilated cardiomyopathy. Now there is also surgical treatment in case the subject is very serious and dilated cardiomyopathy, if it is not sensitive to the therapies or drugs are not well enough to prevent the complication, and in late stage it may complicate to form heart failure also. So dilated cardiomyopathy with time, even in spite of medical management or intervention, can leads to heart failure in long run. Now if the once the heart failed, there is only one option is to do cardiac transplantation or heart transplantation, that is a surgical treatment for those patients whose the dilated cardiomyopathy complicates into heart failure. So for those subjects who have heart failure is a complication of dilated cardiomyopathy, they can go for heart transplant as a surgical treatment. There are various lifestyle modification that can be done as a part and parcel of treatment of dilated cardiomyopathy. So even some the sign symptoms of dilated cardiomyopathy or complication of dilated cardiomyopathy can be prevented by adopting some lifestyle changes. So what are those lifestyle changes? Number one is exercise. Mild to moderate exercise is very much essential for our body because it keeps your heart healthy. At the same time, it also lowers the heart. It also prevents the various risk of heart disease, ischemic heart disease, coronary ischemic events, and so on. But in case of dilated cardiac myopathy, severe and heavy exercise are contraindicated. Why? Because heavy exercise or severe exercise may leads to sudden cardiac death in dilated cardiomyopathy. So heavy weight lifting as well as severe exercise or competitive athletic game or competitive exercise should be avoided, and we must take advice of physicians and doctors before doing any type of exercise in case of patients who are suffering from dilated cardiomyopathy, because severe exercise and competitive exercise as well as heavy weight lifting may be responsible for aggravating the heart failure in dilated cardiomyopathy, and also it increases the risk of sudden cardiac death or sudden heart attack or sudden cardiac death in patients who are suffering from dilated cardiomyopathy. Besides, it is always advisable to avoid or quit smoking, because smoking is a risk factor which is increase the afterload, increase the blood pressure, and it has so much effects on the cardiovascular system. It increases the risk of heart attack, myocardial injury, and so on. So it is always advisable to avoid smoking or to quit smoking as soon as possible once the patient is diagnosed to have dilated cardiomyopathy. Besides, it is always advisable to avoid or to avoid such drugs which are cardiotoxic, like doxorubicin, donorubicin. These are anti-cancer drugs which can harm or injure the cardiac muscle. So those substances or drugs, that is doxorubicin, donorubicin, should be treated with caution or should be taken if needed with caution, as these drugs may increase the risk of dilated cardiomyopathy. Besides, it is always must to stop alcoholism. If the person was on alcohol or heavy dose of alcohol for several years, and if he is diagnosed to have dilated cardiomyopathy, it is always advisable and he must stop alcohol, because stopping alcohol prevents the development or progression of dilated cardiomyopathy or further alcohol-induced damage to the heart muscle, which leads to alcoholic cardiomyopathy, which is a type of dilated cardiomyopathy. So stopping of alcohol is another important lifestyle modification, and alcohol is one of the modifiable risk factors for development of dilated cardiomyopathy. Besides, maintenance of normal healthy weight is very much essential. So we should be conscious. Especially dilated cardiomyopathy patients should be very much conscious so that they don't gain weight, extra weight. And one of the important sign symptoms of dilated cardiomyopathy is that the patient can or may gain weight with time. Thus, it is always advisable to maintain healthy weight by doing mild exercise or to maintain healthy diet. Besides, it is always advisable to take heart healthy diet like fruits and vegetables, low carbohydrate, low sugar, low salt diet, and those and also others diet which are low in saturated fat, cholesterol, and red meat. So food or diet rich in fruits and vegetables are very much essential. Besides, we should cut down the extra salt or low salt diet, low sugar diet, low saturated fat diet, low cholesterol diet, and low trans fat diet. So these are the very heart healthy diet. There is Mediterranean diet is good. We should avoid, or we must avoid, Western diet, which are very much bad for heart. So all these are the various lifestyle changes that we can add up to prevent the progression of the dilated cardiomyopathy. Thank you very much.